We convene this hearing of the Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee to examine how the Centers for Medicare and Medicare Services, CMS, has been implementing the Medicare Secondary Payment Statute. Medicare represents a substantial portion of the federal budget. So with our country facing a $1.4 trillion deficit and an impending debt limit ceiling vote, we must ensure that CMS is properly guarding the legal and financial interests of Medicare beneficiaries while protecting the solvency of the program itself. Generally, Medicare is a primary payer for health claims. If a beneficiary has other insurance, that insurance may fill in all or some of Medicare's gaps. However, the Medicare Secondary Payment Program identifies specific conditions under which another party is legally responsible to be the primary payer. In such cases, Medicare is only responsible for certain secondary payments. The Medicare Secondary Payment Statute was enacted to reduce expenditures under the Medicare program and ensure that Medicare is properly reimbursed for such payments. The law prohibits Medicare payments for any item or service when payment has been made or can reasonably be expected to be made by a third-party payer, such as workers' compensation, auto medical insurance, and all forms of no-fault and liability insurance. Medicare secondary payment payer recoveries fall into two main categories: post-payment collections for injuries that have incurred and were paid out by Medicare, and a set-aside account to cover future medical bills. For post-payment collections, there is widespread concern that CMS is creating unnecessary roadblocks for parties to reach a settlement agreement. Businesses and injured individuals routinely negotiate a settlement, but cannot close on the settlement until CMS provides a complete list of all medical costs incurred. We have heard complaints from a variety of interested parties that CMS is not providing this information in a consistent or in a timely manner. CMS's delays cause lawsuits to drag on, hinders timely payments to injured individuals, and causes uncertainty and increases costs for both large and small businesses. This raises several questions. Why can't CMS more quickly and accurately track medical costs for covered individuals? And is CMS even capable of administering a health payment program for the medical community or accurately tracking costs? Based on a hearing in this subcommittee earlier this year, we already know that CMS cannot accurately measure the amount lost to fraud, and that CMS doles out tens of billions of dollars in improper payments every year. And we have yet to see reliable estimates on the total amount of secondary payment reimbursements that remain uncollected by CMS. In addition to post-payment collections, plaintiffs are supposed to set aside funds to cover future medical costs relating to the initial injury, such as follow-up surgeries or prescription drugs for chronic injuries. However, the reporting requirements are just so weak that CMS may not know about the settlement or whether the set-aside account has been improperly spent on unrelated non-medical expenses. The result is that CMS continues to pay for an injury that was already paid for by a third party. CMS now says that they plan to increase education awareness for the legal community on the requirements of Medicare secondary payer, which has been on the books for almost 30 years. That CMS needs to educate people on a 30-year-old law brings into question what they have been doing for the past 30 years and how effective their outreach efforts have been. I think more needs to be done, obviously. Whenever retailers, insurance companies, and plaintiffs' attorneys are all sending letters to CMS anxious to pay the federal government and they can't get a complete or timely response about how much they owe, the system is badly broken. Hopefully, our witnesses today can help us better understand the underlying problems and we can work in a bipartisan manner to fix this. With that, I'd like to welcome our first panel, Deborah Taylor, Director of Financial Management at CMS, and James Cosgrove, Director of Healthcare from the Government Accounting Office. And I look forward to the testimony. And with that, I welcome the ranking member, Mr. Gett from Colorado, for an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased that we're having this hearing today on Medicare secondary payer issues. We hear over and over again, in fact, I had two town hall meetings this last weekend where I heard from my constituents about how much they value the Medicare program, how important it is to them. Millions of Americans rely on Medicare to pay for visits to their doctors, cover their hospital stays, and help with their prescription drug costs. This hearing today is very important because the Medicare secondary payer program arrangement that you so well described in your opening statement saves taxpayers money while making sure that recipients get the benefits that they need. The Medicare secondary payer rules have saved taxpayers over $50 billion in the last decade. But as you said, the program is not perfect. Beneficiaries, insurance companies, lawyers, and retailers assert that the way the Medicare secondary payer process is handled can create confusion and delay. We heard the story of one Medicare beneficiary who brought a case against a drunk driver that hit her. The case was ultimately settled. The beneficiary was told years later that she had to pay Medicare back using the proceeds of her settlement for medical costs related to the car accident, or that the Treasury Department would seize her Social Security checks. Unfortunately, there are other seniors with similar stories. So, in general, I think that this subcommittee can serve many purposes, and one of the important purposes that we serve is to have sensible congressional oversight of problems with federal programs, because that will then motivate an agency to move more quickly to correct an issue. I'm glad that we have Deborah Taylor here today, the Director of Financial Management at CMS, because I think it's important that we hear from CMS about problems with the program and how the agency is acting to address them. We're really asking the agency to do three things here. First, to protect taxpayer funds. Second, to make sure that beneficiaries can fairly get their health care costs covered. And thirdly, to work with lawyers and insurance companies to obtain justice in cases where they've been injured or harmed. To the extent that this is not happening, I want to hear about how the agency can improve and about whether CMS needs more tools from Congress to make sure that the program works better. I think we can also have illuminating testimony from GAO and representatives from groups that are affected by the Medicare secondary payer rules in the second panel today. You know, we can go on ad nauseum about the problems with this program, but I frankly am most interested in hearing from our witnesses about the solutions to these problems. It's not enough to say that the program is broken. Instead, we have to think creatively about the steps that the agency can take and whether congressional action is needed to help. One possible solution is H.R. 1063, the Strengthening Medicare and Repaying Taxpayers Act, introduced by our colleague Tim Murphy, who was just here a minute ago, and it's a bipartisan bill of which I'm a co-sponsor. Oh, there he is. They promoted you, or demoted you, as the case may be. This fine legislation would take a number of steps to address the problems associated with Medicare secondary payer rules, establish tight new deadlines for CMS to provide information to beneficiaries and their attorneys. And so even though this is not a legislative hearing, I'd like to hear from CMS, GAO, and the other witnesses about whether they think that this type of legislation strikes the appropriate balance between the needs of beneficiaries and the needs of taxpayers, and see if they have any suggestions about how this legislation could be improved. Congress certainly has a legitimate interest in ensuring our constituents are being treated fairly under Medicare secondary payer rules. I look forward to today's hearing and really focusing on the solutions to address any problems that remain. Thank you, and I yield back.
The gentlelady yields back, and the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Burgess, is recognized for 2 minutes.
I thank the chairman. This hearing is an example of what this committee does best in exercising its oversight function, in this case with the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, and to ensure that the process functions as intended, and to ensure today that the Medicare secondary payment system is working as Congress intended, and to see where improvements can be made if indeed there are problems, and there appear to be. Now, it should be intuitively obvious to the casual observer that CMS and third-party payers would communicate with each other about what's owed, what's been paid, and even be able to estimate what future costs when a court case lasts for years. However, these communications have only recently been required. Questions and disagreements and difficulties persist, and many have suggested that improvements can be made. And while the Medicare secondary payment system is only a very small element of Medicare, any dollar which is paid that is not its Medicare's primary responsibility, it's a dollar that can't be recovered, and it's a dollar that's not available to provide another service for another beneficiary. Mr. Chairman, I know our staffs have spoken, and I hope we can continue similar oversight into the Medicaid program as well. Congress has clearly agreed through the false statements and regarding health matters and the Deficit Reduction Act that state Medicare authorities should always work to assure that Medicaid is the payer of last resort. Since 1980, statute has required state Medicaid plans to take a reasonable measures to avoid medical claims for which the beneficiary has other health insurance that is legally primary to Medicaid. In 2003, audits of six Medicaid authorities uncovered problems with between 20% and 36% of claims sampled. Extrapolating nationwide, we could be talking about $45 billion per year. I also look forward to the updated information from the General Accountability Office on the Medicare Secondary Payment System program. At the end of the day, no one wants a medical provider to bill the wrong payer, and no one wants the wrong payer to pay. We want our government programs to know that our government programs are ensuring the proper and legally responsible payer meets their responsibility. We don't want beneficiaries to be shouldered with an unforeseen bill due to lagging communications. Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you. Gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Murphy, is recognized for 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Only in Washington can someone who wants to send money back to the federal government be ignored. But that's a situation we're dealing with now with some of this difficulty we have with this problem. We want to preserve Medicare for seniors. It's important, it's essential, but it's a mess. What is critically important for our seniors' health is also critically ill itself and bleeding money. One aspect of this is that hundreds of millions of dollars that should be repaid to the Medicare Trust Fund are sitting in lawyers' accounts because the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services won't tell those who want to settle lawsuit how much their medical bills must first be repaid to the government. Under the current law, the Medicare Secondary Payer Statute is supposed to ensure that taxpayers don't foot the bill for senior citizens' medical expenses if the injury resulted from a case involving third-party liability. That makes sense, but it loses dollars because the system just doesn't work. Plaintiffs and defense attorneys, retailers, employers, and senior citizens all cry out that the system is a mess, but CMS, like Kevin Bacon's character of Chip Diller in Animal House, raises his hand and says, "Remain calm, all is well." The current MSP system, which we're investigating today, discourages and even prevents companies from settling claims involving Medicare beneficiaries because Medicare won't tell the settling parties how much is owed. That's why I've introduced bipartisan legislation with Representative Ron Kind, the Strengthening Medicare and Repaying Taxpayers Act, the SMART Act, that would compel CMS to provide the medical bills information so the parties could settle within 65 days. This legislation would get money into the trust fund and ensure seniors are paid money that is rightfully theirs quickly. As Jason Mathis, an attorney from Pittsburgh who is here today, will explain, his clients, some of whom are in ill health and depending on that settlement to pay bills and their mortgage, have waited months to hear back from CMS on how much Medicare is owed. If we enact the SMART Act, that senior citizen will receive what is rightfully hers now. The SMART Act will also prevent another kind of horror story. These are cases where Medicare has denied medical treatment to a senior citizen for breast cancer because she received a settlement check related to a chest wall contusion suffered from a slip and fall years ago. This year, Medicare may collect an estimated $230 million from cases like auto accidents and slip and falls. And if the SMART Act were enacted into law, Medicare could see annual collections quadruple to $1 billion per year. We'll also hear how Medicare spends more money pursuing old claims than the amount owed to Medicare. In one example, Medicare spent more on postage notifying the plaintiff of their obligation than the $1.59 owed to the trust fund. The SMART Act would reduce its wasteful expense by ensuring Medicare doesn't spend more money pursuing collections than the amount is actually owed. According to a new study by the RAND Corporation, if Medicare pursued settlements only greater than $5,000, the agency would still recover 98% of the $1 billion I mentioned earlier, but it would reduce the number of claims it dithers away resources on by 43%. So I thank the chairman for this investigation. We have an opportunity with passing the SMART Act to be responsible stewards of the trust fund because all of us deeply care about protecting the Medicare benefits that our constituents, especially our senior citizens, have earned. And I yield back.
I thank gentlemen. The ranking member, Mr. Waxman from California, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The Medicare secondary payer program is complex and arcane. Few people have heard of this program, and even fewer understand it, but that does not mean it is insignificant. The program saves taxpayers billions of dollars, helping to make sure that Medicare is not forced to foot the bill in cases where the other insurers should be paying. This is a worthy goal, and we all have an interest in making this program work. We have two panels today, and I hope they will help us answer one simple question. Is the Medicare secondary payer program working for taxpayers and Medicare beneficiaries? The problem with answering this simple question is that there can be a tension between what works for the taxpayer and what works for beneficiaries. From the beneficiary perspective, the key goals are speed, simplicity, and certainty. Beneficiaries want Medicare to reduce burdens and rapidly give beneficiaries, especially those caught up in legal cases with insurers because of accidents, the information they need about how much they or their insurer will have to reimburse Medicare. Taxpayers have different goals. Taxpayers want the program to leave no money on the table, even if that means waiting to be 100% certain that all funds owed to taxpayers are repaid. I don't envy the job of CMS in finding the right balance here. Today we'll hear from CMS about how they have chosen to run the program and the opportunities they see for improvement. We'll also hear from GAO about key program areas that need investigation. On the second panel, we'll have witnesses representing beneficiaries, trial lawyers, and businesses affected by the Medicare secondary payer rules. They feel that CMS has not obtained the correct balance in the way they have chosen to run the program. This will be a valuable hearing because it can help us determine whether we should enact legislative solutions. Our goal should be to work with CMS and other interested parties to be sure we are appropriately weighing the concerns of beneficiaries and the concerns of taxpayers. Our focus today on making Medicare better, however, we need to recognize how important Medicare is to seniors and to our nation, and we should renounce efforts to end Medicare as we know it. Many of my Republican colleagues have bashed Medicare and supported turning the program over to private insurance companies on the basis that no government program can do an effective job compared to the private sector. When we hear these arguments, one of the key talking points is that Medicare has extremely high erroneous payment rates. Their implication is clear that Medicare's error rate is higher than error rates of private insurers, but that simply is false. Earlier this week, the American Medical Association released their annual report card on insurers. The AMA found that Medicare had the highest payment accuracy rate among all providers, 96%. Private insurers' payment accuracy rates were 5 times higher than Medicare. This is a great example of Medicare leading the way and doing better than the private sector when it comes to cutting waste. Mr. Chairman, you and other members of your caucus or conference voted for the budget that would replace Medicare for people under 55. With a privatized and underfunded voucher system that would cost thousands of dollars more in out-of-pocket health care costs every year, seniors would face the worst of both worlds, the loss of important guaranteed benefits and higher out-of-pocket costs because of the inefficiency of the privatized Medicare model. These dramatic changes to Medicare pose a much greater risk to seniors than the problems in the Medicare secondary payer program. That is why I sent a letter to Chairman Upton last month asking for hearings on the Republican budget's impact on Medicare and Medicaid. Now that we have started Medicare work in this subcommittee, I hope our next oversight hearing can look at the impacts of the Republican budget on this key program for seniors and the disabled. And I yield back the balance of my time.
I thank the gentleman. We welcome our first panel. As mentioned, Deborah Taylor is the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, Chief Financial Officer, CFO, and the Director of the Office of Financial Management, OFM. As CMS's Senior Financial Manager Executive, she is accountable and responsible for planning, directing, analyzing, and coordinating the agency's comprehensive financial management functions. James Cosgrove, doctor, is a director on the healthcare team at the U.S. Government's Accounting Office, GAO, and responsible for GAO studies of healthcare financing and Medicare payment issues with his PhD, not his doctor's PhD. As you know, the testimony you're about to give is subject to Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. When holding an investigative hearing, this committee has a practice of taking testimony under oath. Do you have any objection to testifying under oath? No. The chair then advises you that under the rules of the House and the rules of the committee, you are entitled to be advised by counsel. Do you desire to be advised by counsel during your testimony today? In that case, you please rise and raise your right hand. I'll swear you in. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you. Now, each of you can give your five-minute opening statement. And Ms. Taylor, we'll start with you.
Okay. Good morning, Chairman Stearns and Ranking Member DeGette and members of the subcommittee.
I think, Ms. Taylor, you have to push the button and bring the mic a little closer.
Okay. Good morning, Chairman Stearns, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today to discuss the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services Medicare Secondary Payer Program. The Medicare Secondary Payer Program, also known as MSP, is an important program that protects both Medicare beneficiaries and the sustainability of the Medicare program. The purpose of the MSP program is to ensure that Medicare pays primary when appropriate and recovers monies when Medicare should pay secondary to another insurer. While MSP is specific to Medicare, all insurance providers, public and private, utilize a system similar to the MSP to resolve conflicting coverage issues with other carriers. MSP policies establish when certain other insurance payers have primary responsibility for the healthcare services of a person with Medicare. The MSP program has traditionally had a high rate of return on investment of almost 9-1, and over the past decade has returned savings, both cost avoided savings as well as recoveries in excess of $55 billion. There are two types of MSP situations. The vast majority of MSP situations arise when a Medicare beneficiary is covered by an employer's health care insurance. This is a highly automated process that allows beneficiary claims to be automatically identified where Medicare is not the primary insurer. In these situations, unnecessary costs are avoided and there is no pay and chase required to recover these monies. The second MSP situation arises when a Medicare beneficiary is harmed or injured and receives a settlement payment from another insurer, usually an automobile liability or workers' compensation insurer. These cases are often referred to as non-group health plan cases. These cases require close communication and coordination between CMS, the beneficiary, and their representatives, usually an attorney. In order to ensure continuity of care for Medicare beneficiaries, Medicare may pay conditionally while the health care of the beneficiary under these situations. If Medicare makes a conditional payment, Medicare has a statutory right to recover from the insurer legally required to pay for this care. Prior to 2008, insurers involved in these types of MSP situations had a limited requirement to report their settlements to CMS. When Congress passed the Medicare, Medicaid, and SCHIP Extension Act of 2007, these insurers had a mandatory reporting responsibility to CMS. These mandatory reporting requirements have significantly increased the number of non-group health plan cases. and have provided recoveries to the Medicare Trust Fund estimated to be about $600 million. To facilitate a smooth transition of these mandatory reporting requirements, CMS took a transparent and open approach to establishing the requirements. We developed standardized electronic reporting processes and worked collaboratively with the insurance industry to design and test this process. We established a website where insurers can find all official instructions and guidance related to the mandatory reporting requirements. We held town hall conferences with over 34,000 representatives from insurance industry, trade associations, and attorney groups, and we developed computer-based training on MSP policies and mandatory reporting requirements. As a result of our efforts, the overall number of MSP records posted to CMS's systems has more than doubled over the past 3 years. This increased activity represents a potential for even greater savings to the Medicare Trust Fund in coming years. We continue to leverage technology to improve our processes and further increase our rate of return. We have made Medicare information directly accessible to beneficiaries, their representatives, and the industry. We have expanded the MyMedicare.gov website to provide more information about the MSP program and to assist beneficiaries. We also developed mechanisms to automate many of the reporting and recovery processes. CMS is committed to a transparent MSP process and ensure that Medicare beneficiaries receive the care they need while reducing Medicare payments for claims that are the legal responsibility of another insurer or liable party. We remain committed to improving the MSP program and maintaining strong communications with our beneficiaries, insurers, and other stakeholders. This concludes my statement. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Dr. Cosgrove.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member DeGette, members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to speak to you today as you consider potential improvements to Medicare's secondary payer process. As has been discussed this morning, this process is intended to protect Medicare's fiscal integrity when a beneficiary's Medicare expenses are potentially covered by another insurer. Congress has spelled out rules for when other insurers must pay first. In such cases, Medicare pays second and is only financially responsible for, and should only pay for, those Medicare items and services that are not covered by the primary insurer. For example, Medicare has always been the secondary payer when the beneficiary is covered by a workers' compensation plan. In 1980, Congress made Medicare a secondary payer to other non-group health plans, which include auto or other liability insurance and no-fault insurance. Shortly thereafter, Congress made Medicare the secondary payer in most instances where a beneficiary is currently employed or has a spouse that's currently employed and is covered by an employer-sponsored group health plan. Both group and non-group health plans had a legal obligation to identify situations where they were the primary payers, notify Medicare, and pay appropriately. However, there were concerns that this did not always happen, and that Medicare sometimes paid for care that should have been covered by other insurers. The Medicare, Medicaid, and SHIP Extension Act of 2007 established specific MSP reporting requirements and fines for noncompliance. For non-group health plans, for example, non-group health plans must inform CMS when they've reached a settlement with a beneficiary in an MSP situation. The Congressional Budget Office estimated that the law's provisions would help Medicare recover or avoid $1.1 billion in improper payments over 10 years. Mandatory reporting requirements for group health plans went into effect January 2009. Mandatory reporting for non-group health plans was delayed until January 2011 for certain types of these plans and until January 2012 for the rest. My remarks today will describe the five major components of the MSP process for situations involving non-group health plans. These are notification, negotiation, resolution, mandatory reporting, and recovery. The order of the components and the details of the process and CMS's involvement at various stages may vary somewhat depending on the circumstances of the case. I think the best way to understand how the MSP process works in general is through an example, and that's what's included in our written statements. We have a graphic, and this is figure 2 and page 8 in our written statement, but it tries to illustrate graphically how the MSP process might work when a Medicare beneficiary is injured in an automobile accident. In this simplified example, begins when an injured Medicare beneficiary goes to the hospital. The hospital treats the beneficiary and eventually submits a bill to Medicare. Notification happens when CMS first learns of the MSP situation. In this example, the beneficiary's attorney notifies CMS and requests a list of payments Medicare made to the hospital. CMS's contractor provides this information. And although notified, Medicare may continue to make payments, called conditional payments, so that the beneficiary will have access to necessary medical care while the beneficiary's attorney negotiates with the automobile insurer. Negotiation to reach a settlement takes place between the beneficiary's attorney and the insurer. In this example, the attorney uses the information from CMS to help ensure that the settlement includes funds to reimburse Medicare for payments made related to the claim. Resolution refers to the settlement reached between the beneficiary's attorney and the insurer. In a liability case, the insurer often provides the beneficiary with a lump sum payment. Mandatory reporting is what happens at this point when the insurer reports the resolution to CMS. In some cases, mandatory reporting may be the first notification that CMS gets of the MSP situation. And recovery happens after mandatory reporting, when CMS seeks to recover payments Medicare made related to the claim. While I can describe the key components of the process, I can't tell you how well the process is working. We're aware that concerns have been raised and are currently evaluating certain aspects of the process related to non-group health plans. Specifically, our study is examining aspects of the MSP process that have presented challenges for both non-group health plans and CMS, and it will also look at how mandatory reporting by non-group health plans is expected to affect CMS's MSP workload, its costs, and Medicare savings. We expect to complete our work and report on our findings later this year. We look forward to working with you and others in Congress as you consider this very important issue. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my prepared remarks. I'd be happy to answer any questions you or other members might have.
Yes, I'll start with my questions. Dr. Cosgrove, just it looks like in this resolution area of your graph is where the main problem is. Do you think Congress should step in and make the Medicare payment that is done first, make this such that after the insurance companies pay, then Medicare steps in? In that one chart dealing with resolution where it mm-hmm. seems to be the conflict, is there something you would suggest for Congress to do?
It's really premature for me to comment at that time. We've certainly heard concerns by the non-group health plans raised about how this works right now, but that's part of
our
investigation.
So your answer is no, you don't know.
I don't know yet.
Okay. Ms. Taylor, can you provide information on the number of Medicare secondary payment cases CMS is handling today?
I don't have the exact number, but I can tell you that of the non-group health plan cases, I believe we have about 413,000.
I need you to pull the mic a little closer if you can.
I believe for the non-group health plan cases.
This would include liability, workman's compensation, and no-fault automobile Medicare secondary payment cases.
Correct.
And that's your number is roughly 400?
I believe that's the number that we have right now.
How many were handled last year?
It was far last year, probably about the same.
Okay. Is this typically a number that remains constant every year? Is it roughly about 400?
What I can tell you is that since the Medicare and Medicaid SCHIP Extension Act of 2007, our casework, our workload has more than doubled.
Okay. How long, Ms. Taylor, have you been in this position as a CFO?
For about a year and a half.
And what did you do before that?
I was the deputy to the director of office.
How much money is involved in the Medicare secondary payment process each year? How much is reimbursed to the trust fund?
To the trust fund, last year in 2010, we had about $8 billion, which includes both the group health plan and the non-group health plan cases.
Does CMS keep track of how much money is reimbursed by class or type?
I believe we have that information, but I don't have that.
For example, how much is workers' comp And for example, how much is auto accident?
I believe we can get that information. I just don't have that with me.
In your opinion, is it being reimbursed by class or type? Is it distinguished?
I believe it is, yes. I believe our contractor does maintain information about which type of insurer they are working with, yes.
Do you mind submitting that for the record?
Sure.
Okay. Does CMS ever attempt to estimate the number or amount of secondary payment cases under which CMS does not get reimbursed?
I don't believe we do track that information.
Uh-huh. Who was the position in this position before you?
Prior to me, Tim Hill had the job that I currently have.
And how long was he in that position?
I believe 5 years.
Okay. Does CMS have an idea how much money that should be reimbursed that is not?
I don't think we track it that way, meaning when a case is identified to us, we have to wait till there is, in fact, a settlement. If there is no settlement, the Medicare beneficiary does get paid, and they do get their health care covered by Medicare. Our primary goal is to ensure that Medicare beneficiaries do receive their health care.
On those 400 cases, do you put a suspense time when you go back to staff and say, let's hurry up and try to settle this? Is there any kind of suspense record that you keep?
We don't keep any records that say we need to suspend this case. It is a
I don't mean suspend, but I mean, let's say a case goes on and on and on and on. Do you as a CFO get a weekly or monthly record that's saying of these 400 cases, 50 of them have gone on for 10 months, three months?
I believe we do get information about the age of the cases.
That's what I mean, the age of the
case. What we don't get is the reason for the age.
No,
so
okay.
It could sometimes be because the...
So you physically see this come across your desk, the age?
I don't physically get that, no.
Do you have any interest in seeing that so you can say to the people, let's get moving?
I have an absolute interest in this MSP recovery process, and it is subjected to our audit by our CFO auditors.
How much does CMS spend on conditional payments for treatment and services, coverage for which is the responsibility of non-group health plans on an annual basis? Do you know?
I do not know. I just know what the annual recoveries are.
How much does CMS recover annually for these claims?
Last year we covered about $400 million.
My last question is, experts, industry experts, have told this committee staff that there's at least $4 billion a year for the non-group health claims alone that is not making it to the trust fund. Do you confirm that? Do you have any idea how much money CMS is leaving on the table?
I don't have any information
on that. Does that $4 billion seem reasonable to you?
I honestly couldn't remark on that. We are relying on the individuals to report these cases to us.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin my questions, I want to welcome these close-up students who have joined us. What you're seeing today is the legislative process in action, and oftentimes people from the outside world who come in and see us don't realize that much of what we do is in a bipartisan way in Congress. And what we're trying to do in this hearing today is figure out how we can both protect taxpayers and also Medicare beneficiaries in getting more money recovered from these accidents so that we can keep our program safe and solvent. So this is an oversight hearing, and this is the kind of work this committee does, and we're delighted to have you, and we're sorry we don't have seats for more of you. I want to ask both of our witnesses, Ms. Taylor, Dr. Cosgrove, about some of the key decisions that Congress is facing as we look at the effectiveness of these Medicare secondary payer rules. Ms. Taylor, I think you had said that the Medicare secondary payer program recovered about $50 billion for taxpayers over the last decade. Is that correct?
That is correct. The number is $58
billion. $58 billion. And so obviously this program is important in making sure that taxpayers are protected and that the Medicare program is not paying bills that other insurers should be paying. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct.
And it's also important, though, that the CMS be responsive to the needs and the concerns of the beneficiaries, because it really doesn't make sense, either in a fiscal way, to have beneficiaries to have to wait months to get basic information that they need to reach settlements in cases. And it frankly seems very unfair for beneficiaries to face huge and unexpected demands to pay funds back to Medicare years after they've settled. You know, I was a lawyer. I practiced law for about 15 years. And what I found when I settled these cases was the beneficiaries get the settlement and they're so happy about it that they spend it right away. And then years later, when the government comes back and tries to get this money back, they don't have it anymore, and it's a real burden on them. And so I think it might be fair to say there's a trade-off here between actions that are good for taxpayers, which is recovering these funds, but then that can burden beneficiaries later. And so would that be an accurate statement to say sometimes there's a trade-off there between the taxpayers and the beneficiaries?
We are constantly between that delicate balance of ensuring that the trust funds recover monies while ensuring that our beneficiaries receive the care they need and ensuring that we recover monies that are due back to the trust funds. So, yes,
in a timely fashion, I would say.
Absolutely.
Now, Dr. Cosgrove, can you offer us any insight here based on GAO's work?
Well, our work is just beginning right now, and so we are starting to talk to the affected parties, which certainly include the non-group health plans and to CMS. And our goal in undertaking the study is to understand what the challenges are, but also to understand what the costs are for CMS in terms of implementing the mandatory reporting and what the potential savings might be, which could shed light on and maybe lead towards potential recommendations about improvements for the program, and maybe along such lines as, minimum recovery amounts. But, that's far down the road. We're going to be continuing our work and issuing our report by the end of the year.
By the end of the year, Mr. Chairman, probably I can see a follow-up hearing coming
sure.
along. I would ask you, Ms. Taylor, what recent action has CMS taken to promote the goals that we talked about here of improving the Medicare secondary payer program for beneficiaries and for taxpayers?
There's probably two sets of things that we've done. One is we are making information more accessible to beneficiaries. So we're providing them education about their responsibilities with MSP, but we're also making it able so that Medicare beneficiaries can see their claims real time and be able to tell their attorneys, these are the claims I know have been processed and paid by Medicare. The second part is, we have had a huge workload increase because of the mandatory reporting requirements. This is not an industry we dealt with routinely, the liability, the casualty type insurers. And so we learned a lot over the last 3 years, and we are working to streamline our processes, look at a way to ensure that our contractor has the right skills, and we will be recompeting our contract for these kinds of activities related to the non-group health plans this fall.
And do any of these improvements need congressional action that you think would help?
I can't think of anything off the top of my head, but we'd certainly be happy to work with you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thanks, gentlelady. Gentleman from Texas, Dr. Burgess, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Stearns. And some of my questions are going to follow along the same lines that Chairman Stearns was asking. Ms. Taylor, how long will you have to wait for a settlement? What is a customary period?
So according to our guidelines, we want to work with insurers within 65 days to resolve cases. Then we allow them 30 days for dispute and then another 60 days to sort of resolve that dispute. So ideally, it could take 120, 150 days to resolve a case. We do have workload issues, so there are cases that have aged beyond those 150 days. We certainly know that working on a lawsuit takes mm-hmm. time. So It can take anywhere between the ideal of 120 days to 6 months to resolve a case.
Do any of these cases ever linger for years?
I'm not aware of any, but I certainly have heard that there are stories out there that have lingered on beyond a year.
Is there ever a statute of limitations beyond which you would not try to go back and recover from the beneficiary?
If someone reports something to us, we at least have the responsibility to look into it.
Having run a medical practice, and I feel your pain. I mean, you're having to deal with insurers and lawyers. I mean, the two worst groups that I had to deal with in my professional life. But at the same time, I also know that the bulk of your accounts receivable, if you will, which is what we're talking about, if it gets up much past 90 to 120 days, that's money that you may just never see. Right. So someone always has to be working that or reestablishing why it is that it's taking so long. Now, does that happen at the level of Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, or is that, you mentioned a contractor, is that something that's contracted out?
It is something that is contracted out, and as I mentioned, this is not an industry we had typically dealt with in the past. We know that we need to change our processes. We probably need some different skill sets at our contractor, and we will be making some changes in that area.
Now, do the contractors that you hire, do they have any performance guidelines that they're required to meet?
They do, yes, but they did not anticipate some of the activities we're seeing now.
Well, and how are we overcoming that lack of anticipation now?
We are rewriting a statement of work with very different metrics and different performance requirements.
And these contractors, is this a competitive bidding situation?
Yes.
Where you put these requests for proposals?
It will be going forward.
It will be,
yes.
but currently are these competitively bid currently?
The current contractor was not quote-unquote competitively bid, but it was and done under all the FAR requirements that the government requires.
But going forward, you're actually going to go beyond that?
Yes, absolutely.
How long do you anticipate that will require?
We expect to have a statement of work on the street this fall.
And you'll share that with the committee, obviously. Dr. Carlsgrove, let me ask you a question on your Figure 2 illustration on page 8. It seems as if, and maybe I missed the discussion, but at some point in these little block diagrams, the mandatory reporting block diagram, there's got to also be an arrow going back to the beneficiary, informing them of their responsibilities under this, because what Mr. Getz said was exactly correct. You have someone who, it's been so far removed, the accident, the medical costs, the reimbursement, and now they get this nice check because their government loves them and sent them a check because they were injured, and so it's theirs to spend. I mean, I understand how that thought process works. How can we improve that loop so that the beneficiary has some understanding of what their obligations are, what their requirements are under the law?
Well, I think that's an excellent that's an excellent point, because that's critical for the beneficiary to understand their responsibilities. My understanding from the work that we've done so far is that partly the responsibility is on CMS to provide information to beneficiaries so they know what their responsibilities are. I frankly don't know right now what the non-group health plan's responsibilities are to do similar when the recovery is
for notification.
But that's something we'd definitely be looking into.
All right, thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. The gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Dingell, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, you are most courteous. I thank you for having this hearing, and I appreciate your concern for the questions before us, i.e. how long it takes for us to get the answers on the costs and other matters. My questions are for Mrs. Taylor. For the following questions, please answer yes or no. Ms. Taylor, it's my understanding that CMS works with Medicare Secondary Payer Recovery Contractor that is responsible for determining what MSP payments are subject to recovery, issuing demand letters for this recovery, collection of MSP claims for beneficiaries, making initial determinations for waivers and appeals, amongst other responsibilities. So, a common complaint is the general delay in communication. Some say days, some say months. This delay is frustrating to everybody. Now, does CMS currently require the contractor to respond to communications, whether by mail, email, written correspondence from beneficiaries or attorneys within a specific timeline? Yes or no?
Yes.
You do. What is that timeline?
I believe it's 65 days.
Is it honored?
We do have workload issues that have created the inability for the contractor to get back.
We'll be asking some information about that. Does CMS or the contractor collect data on the average response time in these communications? Yes or no?
I believe they do, yes.
Now, can you tell me what the average response time is? Submit that for the record, if you please. Now, a very similar complaint is the length of time it takes to identify the amount of MSP payments owed to CMS. Does CMS or the contractor collect data regarding the average time needed to identify and recover funds under the MSP program? Yes or no?
That's a difficult one to answer yes or no to. They do it whatever is based on the information in the system. So, yes, they do it as quickly as they can. The problem is claims lag.
Would you submit that in greater detail for the record, please? Now, could you tell me what the average time might be?
I don't.
Please submit that for the record. Now, a further concern is the length of time it takes for beneficiaries and their attorneys to obtain a demand letter that informs the beneficiary and their attorney of the MSP claim. This delay impedes the ability of beneficiaries and their attorneys to move forward towards a settlement and, again, ultimately delays reimbursement to Medicare. Does CMS currently require the contractor to issue a demand letter within a specific timeline? Yes or no?
Yes.
You do. Now, would you submit for the record what that average response time is?
Yes.
Now, next question. In your opinion, Director Taylor, what is needed to improve the responsiveness of CMS and its contractors to beneficiaries and their attorneys? Is it a new contractor that is better equipped to handle these claims, or is it the need for additional funding and personnel to manage the caseload? Finally, another concern raised by a witness on the second panel, Mr. Salm of Publix, is the inefficiency of pursuing smaller claims. His testimony cites the example of Medicare pursuing cases as small as $1.59. Now, I'm just a poor Polish lawyer from Detroit, but even I know that staff time used to collect a claim here for $1.59 would far exceed the recovery. Question, does CMS have in place a threshold for MSP recovery?
We do not, but we are looking at that, yes.
Do you think that that's something that you ought to do, because you may be wasting money and flailing around trying to collect money that, frankly, is far too small to confer any benefit on you in view of the costs?
We are looking at that, absolutely. We think we can establish a threshold. I will comment, though, that it is an automated process. Once a beneficiary's case is identified and claims are identified associated with that case, it is an automatic generated bill. So it's not a manual process.
I'd like to have you make a submission for the record on that point. Next question. Does CMS have in place a threshold for MSP recovery? I think you've indicated that that's not, meaning that an MSP claim is, if it's less than the cost of staff time to collect, CMS or the contractor would not pursue. Yes or no?
That is correct.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I note that I have gone 19 seconds over.
Well, I thank the gentleman emeritus of the full committee.
Hello.
And I hope, Ms. Taylor, that Mr. Dingell's request that you made note of them, I didn't see you make note of them, our staff did, but he has requested quite a bit of information, which I think would be useful for both sides to see, and I think his point is well taken, that the fact that you're continuing to pursue something for $1.30 or something like that after 30 years, it seems like that should have $1.59. That it, after all 30 years, it seems like you should have thought that out. I'd be glad to yield.
To get answers to the questions and see to it that they're put in the record, and I would ask unanimous consent that the record remain open for the purposes of receiving the answers to be that have been requested.
By unanimous consent, so order. And with the chair, the ranking member, the emeritus of the full committee's background on Medicare, it's very helpful for the oversight, and I appreciate his participation. With that, we recognize Mr. Murphy for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Taylor, you're the Chief Financial Officer and Director of the Office of Financial Management for the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services.
Right? Correct.
All right. Now, you cited this number, 413,000 cases, which you said is a large number and has strained the system. Am I correct on that?
That is the number for the non-group health plan.
Non-group health plans, and that's the concern we have talking about here. What's the median value of those 413,000 claims?
I don't have the dollar figures in front of me. I'm sorry about that.
Okay. You get that information to us? Do you have any information, for example, of how many might be under $50 or $100, $500, $1,000?
I don't know that off the top of my head, but the reporting requirement is at $5,000. So $5,000 for liability, and I believe it's $7,500 for workers' comp. So.
Do you even collect information or on things under $5,000? I mean, you send out letters for $1.59. We have that established.
Correct.
But you don't collect the data on how many cases you have of that sort, of that 413,000?
We track how much the cases are, but I don't know that I have that with me at this moment, no.
I'm confused because on one hand you're saying you don't get that information, but you can get the information?
We get, if someone reports a case to us, the threshold is $5,000 to report a case. So if there's a settlement for $3,000, they would not be required to report that case to us.
All right. So if you don't have that information, you're going to have difficulty getting us the information. If you don't have the information as the chief financial officer, you don't have the information you need to be the CFO. That's just my observation. And I would think it would be foolish of me to say if I found a coupon that I could get a can of tomato soup for 10 cents, but I had to drive 100 miles to a store to get it, somehow in that judgment I'd say it's probably not worth it for me to do that, which brings us back to this information. And this tags along with what the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Dingell, said on a number of these claims that are a small number. If the actual cash value is so small that it costs us more to pursue it than to get it, but I'm not sure you have the data to do that. It may not be that we're able to take action on that. But let me ask a couple more things here. We don't know the median value of these claims. We don't know things about that. Is it true that in Section 111 of the statute, it's going to require collection of information about a settlement so long as it's greater than one penny, even if there were no medical bills? Am I correct that that's in the?
I'm not aware of that portion of the provision.
Okay. Probably a good thing for the CFO to know. What about, my understanding is that's true. And if there was a $25 gift card given out by a store to settle a potential case with a senior citizen, you'd want to know that too. That's another. It was another level of settlement, but I understand that that's being asked for. Will you get us that information?
Yes.
I'm frustrated here because we're trying to get information on something. I'm not sure you collect the very data that we're trying to find out. I've heard the current reporting system is prone to error and that CMS rejects a high percentage of the reports when first submitted. Any idea how many reports are initially rejected versus completed on the initial submission?
I'm not aware of that number. I do know that we have reporting requirements and reporting elements that are required. So it could be that cases are rejected because data is not provided adequately.
Are you aware of something I referenced in my opening statement here, that RAND Corporation just completed a study that found if you only looked at settlements greater than $5,000 instead of every single settlement, your collections would fall by only 2.4%, but the number of claims you were pursuing would fall by 43%, and you still collect roughly $1 billion from non-group health plans if you only looked at claims greater than $5,000. Are you familiar with that RAND study?
I am not familiar with that RAND study.
Have you looked at putting in a threshold dollar level for that then?
We absolutely are looking at that right now.
Okay. Is this just in the earliest levels of review of this whole issue from your agency?
Yes, it is.
I guess it comes down to this, too. It would be very beneficial for Congress and obviously for Medicare, which I know you care deeply about its financial stability. That's why you're in the job you're in. It would help us all, and I think we're on the same team, if we could find what kind of saving is in this. With Medicare basically going bankrupt, and I'm sure you're having many a nail-biting moment trying to find the dollars for this, it would really help us if you could just really open all the drawers and lift up all the rugs and find everywhere possible in this to make this more efficient. And I hope you'll also take a look at the SMART Act that a number of us on both sides of the aisle have submitted. And finally, I might suggest this, and ask this, have you met with the people who have a stake in this, such as defense attorneys, plaintiff's attorneys, retailers, senior citizens, to ask for their input on some of this information too?
I personally have met with some of those organizations, but folks who work for me have met with many more.
Well, I would hope that you'll take a look at our act, and I hope you'll sit around to listen to some of the witnesses today, because I think that'll be eye-opening for you. I'll yield back my time, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yields back. The gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to follow my colleague from Pennsylvania. And you're required by law when you put these paying requirements in place. Is that correct?
Correct.
So the first year it's $5,000, and it goes down to $200. Let's see, $2,000 and the $600. And he mentioned the RAND study, the RAND Institute for Civil Justice study. But for us to be able to let you do anything like that, we actually need to change the law.
Correct.
Okay. And I agree with my colleague that, you know, we need to make sure we get the reimbursement that's, you know, instead of double paying, we also need to make sure it's economically feasible.
Mm-hmm.
And so whether it be exempting $5,000 because you spend less than 43%, or if, you'd only lose $24 million, it would seem like it would be cost effective to do that. So maybe that's something our committee needs to look at and something we could work on together. But my main question is, I'd like to ask you about contractor performance of work recovering funds owed to Medicare under the secondary payer rules. In 2006, CMS consolidated the Medicare secondary payer recovery contracts into a single $200 million cost-plus contract. CMS awarded the contract on a sole source basis to Chickasaw Nation Industries, a tribally owned firm based in Oklahoma. The contract responsible for identifying Medicare payments to be recovered, calculating the total amount of the medical payments potentially ripe for recovery, issuing recovery demand letters, and tracking secondary payer debt. In 2009, the Senate Subcommittee on Contracting Oversight initiated an investigation into the Medicare secondary payer contractor. The investigation revealed there were ongoing problems with the contract. For instance, CMS's independent auditors concluded that the combination of control deficiencies constituted a significant deficiency. CMS has also found that the contractor failed to comply with contract requirements. The contractor failed to adequately manage its cases and had major accounting problems. Ms. Taylor, in 2010, the Senate Subcommittee on Contracting Oversight called a hearing, and at the hearing, Rodney Benson, Director of Acquisitions and Grants Management at CMS, testified. It's now over a year later, and what has CMS done to improve the performance of that recovery contractor?
I can tell you that we have made several trips to that contractor. We have put them on corrective action, and as I mentioned before, we are working on a statement of work that will be released this fall, and we will be recompeting that work.
Is there a way you can get that information to our committee? And, Mr. Chairman, I'd appreciate if we could see what the progress has been made with that contractor. Do the improvements of CMS and the contractor fully rectify the problems in the process?
It has rectified some of the problems. Yes, it has.
Okay, great. How long does that contract run?
Okay. I believe it is up middle of 2012, June or July of 2012.
What process would you use to select a new contractor?
It would be a competitive process. So we would put very specific requirements in a statement of work with performance metrics, and we would be accepting bids, and we would be reviewing those bids based on that statement of work.
I'm concerned with the problems identified with the contractor, and this contractor received the contract through sole source process, and CMS's independent auditors have found that the contractor failed to comply with his contract requirements, and I'm hopeful the CMS will continue to address the problems with the contractor and continue to improve the recovery process, particularly when the contract is up for renewal.
Yeah.
So we don't see what's happened again. Again, it was a $200 million contract, $200 million cost-plus contract. Do you have any idea on how much it's cost us so far for that contractor?
I believe it's a $55 million contract annually. So over 4 or 5 years, it would be $200 okay. million. But, yes. It's
okay. Have there been any, outside of working with the contractor, have there been any penalties on their reimbursement based on the quality of their work?
I'm not aware of any, no.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, if we could also check on that, and I know I'm almost out of time, so I appreciate you.
No, I Ms. Taylor, I think Mr. Green's made some great points. I hope you're keeping copious notes. Okay. The gentleman from Georgia is recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you, and I want to thank the first panel and very important hearing, and the information that you've given has been straightforward, but from both of you, and I certainly appreciate that. Ms. Taylor, I will direct my first question to you. One of the main complaints that we've heard from those involved in the Medicare secondary payment payer process, is that they're unable to get a clear statement from CMS as to the amount that must be repaid to the Medicare Trust Fund. Your testimony discusses that if there is a disagreement on the amount of the money owed to Medicare, an individual can file for a waiver or seek an appeal. I think it would be very helpful if you could describe that process to us and how long it takes.
Sure. The waiver process typically is where there is a small dollar settlement. What happens is our rights are preserved after the settlement occurs. The beneficiary deducts attorney fees or any out-of-pocket costs that the beneficiary incurred as a result of whatever injury or harm they suffered. And so the amount that then is in, I won't call dispute, but the amount that then Medicare can use to recover any is based on the net of the settlement minus attorney fees and any out-of-pocket costs to the beneficiary. If those amounts are less than out-of-pocket, if the settlement is less than the attorney fees or out-of-pocket costs incurred by the beneficiary can waive any amounts owing to Medicare.
Okay, thank you. Second question for you also, Ms. Taylor. Members of the committee have been informed that the current Medicare secondary payer process contains an unfortunate paradox. In some cases, that CMS takes a position that it cannot or will not specify the amount owed to the Medicare Trust Fund until after a settlement is reached, but it is that amount that is needed before the parties can settle. Why is this? How does that happen?
So the issue there is the amount of time it takes to process claims. Providers have up to a year to submit a claim. If that claim is not submitted, Medicare still preserves the right to collect against that claim. So,
is it the official position of CMS that they will not provide an amount before settlement?
No, CMS provides an interim amount. So we can look through the claims data and say this is what we believe the claims are that have been processed. The problem is we can't finalize that number till after there is a settlement. Then we can look through the claims and we have to. There can be a lag in the receipt of those claims.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Cosgrove, I want to direct these questions to you. Does the Government Accountability Office believe that there are areas of the Medicare secondary payer regime that should be fixed? And what are those areas?
Well, we don't know yet.
Question, but.
Right. We don't know yet, but that's exactly the intention of the study that we're undertaking right now. Certainly, you know, we have heard concerns that the process may not be working as well as it should be. The non-group health plans have raised concerns about some of the difficulties that they're facing, and so one of the key objectives of the study is to examine the challenges for the non-group health plans and for CMS in implementing this process, as well as then also looking at what are the potential Medicare savings, what are the costs that CMS is incurring to do this, and what's the
Cosgrove, excuse me for interrupting you, but you had, I think, said earlier in your testimony or in response to a member's question when this study will be completed. Would you tell me again when
it's expected by the end of this year.
By the end of this year.
Right. We're in the early stages right now.
Last question that I have, and again, it's for you. Has GAO ever done any work evaluating the public's knowledge of the need to reimburse Medicare? Now, the reason I ask that question is because this whole issue of subrogation comes mm-hmm. up, and I don't know whether you're aware of the fact that I have a medical liability tort reform bill called the Health Act, and one of the provisions in that bill says collateral source disclosure, which in most state courts that's not required, and neither the defendants nor the plaintiff understands the need for that, and clearly doesn't know about this subrogation rule that is in law in regard to reimbursing Medicare, whereas most probably private insurance companies don't have any right to subrogation of that settlement or claim that the plaintiff receives. So the question again, has GAO ever done any work evaluating the public's knowledge of the need to reimburse Medicare?
I'm not aware of any such study.
Do you think that would be important?
Absolutely. I think that it is important. This is important for beneficiaries. It could be a substantial financial liability that they face, and they need to be fully informed.
Well, I think you're right, and I certainly agree with that. I see I've already gone over my time, but thank you all. Thank both of you very much. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlemen. Ms. Shinkowski is recognized for 5 minutes.
Shinkowski.
Gentleman from Illinois. Gentlelady from Illinois.
Thank you, my friend, Mr. Chairman. I am glad that we on a bipartisan basis are looking at ways to make Medicare more efficient. I am grateful to the evaluators who are looking at it, to you, Director Taylor, and to my colleagues, because I believe in Medicare and that we want to make this system as strong as possible, the trust fund as strong as possible. And when I hear about the problems that we have in collecting in a timely way from other party payers, I think about the Republican plan, which would turn over the whole system to private insurers. And I'm picturing lawyers, and I'm picturing a balkanization of lots of different insurance companies in charge of the whole program, and the effect that that could have on beneficiaries in trying to get paid for the services that they need. And I think that making Medicare work better and collecting where we should is the focus that we ought to have, not a new system where we say, oh, okay, go to private insurance companies, you figure out how they're going to pay for in a timely way the health care that you need, because we already have evidence that it is difficult. And now we'll set these elderly people free on their own to try and get that money. So I want this to go right. So, Director Taylor, we're going to hear from witnesses on the second panel that the current Medicare secondary payer system is, quote, making it extremely difficult to settle claims in a prompt and efficient manner, unquote. That's the Gilliam testimony. And, quote, harming beneficiaries and, ironically and unfortunately, harming the trust fund as well, unquote. And that's from the Matz's testimony. So I wonder if you would respond to these characterizations.
Sure. I will say that one of the things is we have been working very closely with industry to ensure that everyone understands their reporting requirements. I think that it is taking time for everybody to learn sort of their responsibilities. We have put all of our instructions out for industry to understand. Our requirements are automated. We've made it accessible, either automated or online ability to report to us. And, you know, I think we are doing everything we can to work very closely with industry to ensure that everyone has an opportunity to improve the process.
Let me say this. Years ago, when I was on the Oversight Committee and I worked with Steve Horn on the Government Efficiency Subcommittee, we would bring in agencies, and then 6 months later, they'd come back and we'd say, well, have you made progress? And unfortunately, more often than not, it hasn't been made. And I would suggest, Mr. Chairman, that we do a follow-up here, you know, that we've identified problems, you've identified problems that exist, that we hold ourselves and you accountable to make sure that we come back and check on that and see if the systems that you put in place, perhaps and maybe hopefully a new contractor. By the way, are we talking again about a single contractor, competitive bidding for a single contractor?
Yes, we are.
And would you speak to that a little? Is that the best way to go, do you think, having one contractor handle this?
Well, the reason we went to one contractor is we did have a study by GAO that said we had misapplication or inconsistent application of our MSP policies across contractors. So we did consolidate. Beneficiaries do transition across the country, so it made it difficult for beneficiaries to navigate different contractors. So we do think it made sense to consolidate with one contractor.
Well, then how can we deal with the workload issue, which you've identified as a big problem? Are we going to be able to fix that with one contractor?
We are, as part of the statement of work, we're looking at parts of the contractor specializing in different insurer types of reporting. So that a contractor might have a unit that deals with just the automobile insurers, or that may deal with the property and casualty insurers, or that would just do workers' comp, so that they specialize and operate with certain industries and that they do have those skill sets to navigate.
I'm out of time, but let's get it right, and let's make sure we'll check back that we have gotten it right. Thank you.
I thank Ms. Shankowski. And now we recognize Mr. Griffith for Virginia for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Earlier this year, the President issued an executive order requiring agencies to review regulations to determine how they could be streamlined to operate in the most effective and efficient manner. Has any part of the Medicare secondary payer process been identified or reviewed as a part of the President's executive order? And if so, which parts?
We have reviewed the MSP program, and we have at least put forward the need to have more transparency into the process. So we have looked at issuing regulation surrounding the MSP program.
Okay, but specifically regarding the President's executive order, have any parts been identified as a part of that executive order, as a response to that executive order?
The main part is the requirement for mandatory reporting and what the responsibilities are surrounding that.
And you may not be in a position to answer these questions, and I understand that, but this is just something I'm curious about. When you have somebody who's injured, and we'll use that classic automobile case, how do you separate out the settlement as being for medical expenses and for pain and suffering? That would be number one. Number two, when you're looking at ongoing expenses, how do you determine, you know, do you keep going on the ongoing expenses until you've eaten up the entire settlement, or is there some division that's made? And last but not least along this line of questioning, what provisions are made to recognize that in a personal injury case, that the plaintiff has borne the expense of paying the attorney out of the settlement, and does, in fact, your process recognize that and give credit for those attorney's fees as a part of the settlement?
It does. The part that we recover is the net of the settlement, taking out attorney's fees and any out-of-pocket costs for the beneficiary. I think it's more difficult to define the pain and suffering part of that settlement, and sometimes we've been told, at least, that the pain and suffering does sometimes include the health care costs for that beneficiary or the future health care costs of that beneficiary. So pain and suffering is defined by what their injury is and the cost of those health care services that will be needed for them.
And I guess that's where it gets, where we've heard the indication that sometimes it's hard for you all to give folks a number.
Correct.
But it also makes it hard for the people trying to figure out, you know, how to settle a case without going through a lengthy, litigious process when they don't know what the lien is going to be.
Right.
But anyway. All right. I thank you very much. I yield back my time, Mr. Chairman.
Let me yield back. Ms. Taylor, before you go, I think as Mr. Dingell and others have pointed out, there's a whole list of things we've given you. It seems like there's lots of times you did not know. It seems like since you're the CFO, the chief financial officer, a lot of the questions we ask you, you should have known. For example, number of claims for small dollar amounts. 2, the response times for getting information and payments to beneficiaries. 3, medium amount of the money involved with the 413,000 cases. 4, your threshold you didn't seem to be aware of. 5, you had no idea how much CMS is failing to collect. 6, I was asking about the duration time for the claim settlement. You didn't have any idea. So I just want to tell you, I think that the feeling on both sides is that you just didn't seem to know much. And so we caution you that if you come back for a second hearing, we expect you to be able to answer these questions. Mm-hmm. I assume you bring staff with you so that these questions, you can certainly ask your staff to help you. But to see a CFO know so little was a little disappointing. With that, we'll have the second panel come up. And I hope, Ms. Taylor, you'll stick around so you can hear some of the problems, serious problems. This would be beneficial to you as a CFO to hear the second panel more specifically address some of the things we talked about. I want to welcome the second panel. Mark Solemn is Vice President of Risk Management at Public Supermarkets, where he is responsible for claims, consumer litigation, insurance purchase, and risk transfer. Scott Gilliam is Vice President and Government Relations Officer with the Cincinnati Insurance Company. He's responsible for representing the company's interests with state and federal governments as well as other outside groups. Jason Matsu is a partner in the law firm of Ratzman, Freshman, and Matsu, where he practices tort and injury law representing dozens of Medicare beneficiaries. He's also an adjunct professor of law at the University of Pittsburgh School of Law. Eileen Stein is the federal policy director for the Medicare Rights Center's Washington, D.C. office. I want to welcome the second panel. As you know, the testimony you're about to give is subject to Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. When holding an investigating hearing, this committee has a practice of taking testimony under oath. Do you have any objection to taking testimony under oath? No? The chair then advises you that under the rules of the House and the rules of the committee, you're entitled to be advised by a counsel. Do you desire to be advised by a counsel during your testimony today? In that case, you please rise and raise your right hand. I swear you in. You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God. Thank you very much. And now, Mr. Salem, we invite you with your five-minute summary of your opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Stern, ranking members of the student members of the committee. Thank you for holding this. To offer several suggestions and ways in which the program could be strengthened to benefit Medicare beneficiaries, affected stakeholders, and taxpayers across the United States. I'm the Vice President of Risk Management for Public Supermarkets, one of the nation's largest employee-owned supermarket chains. In 2010, we employed 148,000 people across 1,036 stores in five states. In the chairman's district alone, Publix operates 38 stores. We have 4,495 associates living in your district, Mr. Chairman, and 5,160 associates who work in your district. We are proud that in the history of Publix supermarkets, we have never laid off a single employee, and that we are consistently ranked as one of the best places to work in the United States. I am also appearing today as a representative of the MARC Coalition, which is a broad-based group of affected shareholders. Let me start by explaining to you what my view is of how the MSP process works through the following liability example. Imagine that Mr. Jones, who is a 76-year-old, falls down a flight of stairs at the Acme store and is hospitalized overnight with a broken leg. Mr. Jones is billed $40,000 by the hospital, which Medicare covers and pays at some reduced rate, let's say for this example, $10,000. 2 years later, Mr. Jones sues Acme. Acme wants to settle, but knowing that Medicare has paid for Mr. Jones's medical expenses, it knows that Medicare will have to be reimbursed. Acme asks Medicare how much it owes for Mr. Jones's care. Medicare, however, will not pay that figure, will not tell Acme that figure, claiming that it cannot do so until the case actually settles. Yet Mr. Jones and Acme cannot settle unless they know Medicare's numbers. This is the untenable paradox mentioned by Congressman Kingray. It is impossible for parties to figure out how much Medicare has actually paid. At best, the parties will typically hold a settlement in escrow for months while the process plays out. And sometimes the Medicare demand comes back as a very small amount, as we've heard referred to. Even if the case does settle, Acme and its insurers have to report the settlement to Medicare under the recent 2006 amendments to the MSP laws. Now, that might sound straightforward enough, but to do so, we will need Mr. Jones's Social Security number to verify that he is a beneficiary, and we also have to identify his health information claim number, or HICN, as well as 200 other pieces of information about Mr. Jones, many of which insurers and defendants in cases have never previously collected. If they fail to report, Acme and its insurance companies face potential penalties of up to $1,000 per day or $365,000 per year. And some of this data is very obscure that they've asked us to collect. This system hurts the beneficiaries who are unable to receive their settlements quickly because Medicare is getting in the way. It also hurts the Medicare Trust Fund because the funds are delayed even as we are prepared to pay. And it hurts businesses like Publix who have incurred incredible additional costs due to the inefficiencies of today's system. I want to share with the committee two recommendations on the way Congress can improve the MSP process and to make it work more efficiently. First, I recommend that Congress address the MSP system and allow CMS, before the final settlement, to provide settling parties with the final amount of health care costs that CMS has previously paid. If Congress does so, the beneficiaries will be able to settle faster, the defendants will be able to settle efficiently and with certainty, and the trust fund will recover more money faster. This is a true win-win-win for all the parties. Secondly, I want to recommend a threshold for small-dollar claims so that we can be sure that the amount of money the government is spending pursuing these claims does not exceed the amount of money that the government will recover from these claims. And let me explain. I have seen claims where settlements are being held up because Medicare has made demands of $1.59, $2.81, or other such small sums. I have a number of examples with me today. This is a waste of taxpayer resources, and it surely costs the Medicare program more money than they're recovering for, so even $1 or $2 or $50 to process these claims. These should all be exempt from the program. Now, we heard a reference to the Rand Institute study, which was just published yesterday, and I have a copy of the study with me, and it indicates that if CMS exempted from MSP all liability claims below $5,000, they would be reducing the agency workload and save costs on an estimated 43% of the claims while only sacrificing 2.4% of the money. That's $24 million of projected loss to on a $1 billion to be recovered. It's a waste of taxpayer money for the agency to spend 43% of its time pursuing 2.4% of its dollars. And at Publix supermarkets, we settle thousands of claims every year below this $5,000 threshold. The subcommittee in Congress can bring common sense to the MSP system by introducing a threshold below which MSP should not apply. The threshold could be a flat dollar amount, such as $5,000, as suggested by the Rand Institute, or it could be set prospectively at the amount of settlement is likely to yield an MSP collection at or below the government's recovery cost. This would not only save the government money, but would allow Medicare beneficiaries to settle small claims without being subject to the extensive, intrusive, and costly MSP reporting process. On behalf of Public Supermarkets, I want to thank you for your leadership in addressing these important issues in partnerships with our associates and our customers. We look forward to working with Congress to address these issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Gillian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the subcommittee. Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity to provide testimony on how the Medicare secondary payer system can be improved to protect Medicare beneficiaries and speed reimbursements to the Medicare Trust Fund. My name is Scott Gillum. I'm Vice President and Government Relations Officer with the Cincinnati Insurance Company, one of the nation's top 25 property casualty insurer groups, marketing business, home, auto, and life insurance in 39 states. I am testifying today on behalf of my company and the Medicare Advocacy Recovery Coalition, MARC, a group which seeks to bring improvements and efficiencies to the MSP system. Today, I would like to tell you about the numerous problems the current MSP system has caused, not only for our company, but for the innumerable Medicare beneficiaries that we interact with in the course of settling thousands of personal injury claims every month. To put this aspect of our business in perspective, we settled over 40,000 personal injury liability claims last year, paying out over $580 million to settle those claims using the services of our 730 field claim representatives who are located around the country. Unfortunately, the current MSP system is making it extremely difficult to settle claims in the prompt and efficient manner we believe injured parties deserve, and is having significant negative impact on claimants who are Medicare beneficiaries. Mr. Salm has already addressed the problems caused by the backwards manner in which CMS collects reimbursements owed to the Medicare Trust Fund. In my testimony today, however, I'd like to focus on several critical problems with the MSP Section 111 reporting process, which imposes extremely complicated data reporting requirements on those of us who settle claims with Medicare beneficiaries. CMS could have implemented the new reporting process through formal rulemaking, which would have allowed for stakeholder input. Instead, the agency created a complex and broad-reaching system without engaging the affected community. The resulting MSP reporting system involves a complex computer submission process that requires responsible reporting entities, REEs, those of us who settle claims, to submit a significant amount of data to CMS, alerting the agency that we have paid a settlement or a judgment to a beneficiary. Unfortunately, we do not have access to many of the data elements that CMS requires us to report, and claimants are often unwilling or even unable to provide the data to us. To give you an idea of the scope and complexity of the reporting system, I have brought with me today the CMS user guide that we have to follow to report the data. It's like a telephone book. And at my company, we've been spending 2 years trying to implement this. And here is the flow chart we use in our claims department to try and figure out how to report the data. The reporting requirements not only impact the claims paying community, they can also have a negative impact on Medicare beneficiaries as well. Consider what happens when the Medicare computer system decides that a beneficiary's current injury or ailment is connected to the primary payer who reported an unrelated payment in the past. Here's a good example. We settled a claim with a woman who was in a car accident and reported the settlement to Medicare. Years later, the woman was diagnosed with breast cancer, and Medicare denied coverage for her treatment on the grounds that her breast cancer was related to the prior car accident. This may sound absurd, but it's a true story from our claim files.
Can you move the mic just a little closer?
Sure.
Yeah, go ahead.
While these reporting requirements are intended to ensure that Medicaid is made aware of cases where it can assert MSP claims, in practice, however, these complex reporting requirements often slow down settlements and in many cases prevent settlements from even happening. In these situations, money that otherwise could have been promptly returned to the Medicare Trust Fund is delayed, reduced, or never paid. This is especially true in cases for the innumerable claimants who are not represented by an attorney and are intimidated by requests to turn over their private personal information in order to settle their claim. One of the particularly problematic elements of the Section 111 reporting process is that it requires insurance carriers to collect Social Security numbers or health insurance claim numbers, HICNs, from all parties with which we settle claims. Our claimants are loath to provide this information and in many cases flatly refuse. and it is little wonder they refuse. Can you imagine having someone who you believe has caused you an injury and who you are now considering suing demand that you hand over their Social Security number? And to make matters worse, the same agency that requires us to collect SSNs or HICNs from Medicare beneficiaries runs advertising campaigns to prevent Medicare fraud by discouraging Medicare beneficiaries to give out those numbers. Shouldn't this be reason enough for CMS to come up with a better way for us to identify Medicare beneficiaries for MSP reporting? Perhaps Congress could help the agency solve this problem so that we can navigate the process without requiring disclosure of SS numbers. A simple solution would be only to require reporting of the last four digits of the Social Security number, a method Medicare already uses to match beneficiaries with their Medicare Part D plan. If CMS can use the last four digits of an SS number in the Part D program, why can't they use it in the MSP program? Another significant problem with the current system is draconian penalties. Those of us who pay claims face a mandatory $1,000 per day claim penalty for failing to properly report a claim. We agree that harsh penalties should be used to pursue bad actors who purposefully circumvent the system, but we also believe that Medicare should promptly. However, the mandatory penalties for reporting failures mean that even companies like ours that are doing their utmost to achieve full compliance can face massive penalties for small errors or technical problems that occur through no fault of our own. Our company has invested 2 years of financial and human resources in developing an information technology system to manage MSP reporting, and despite our feverish efforts and full committee compliance, we could still face massive penalties if even a single data element is entered incorrectly, okay, or our computer systems have a problem or the CMS problem.
Mr. Galina, I need you to sum up.
Yes, I will.
Yeah.
I will now go to wrap up quickly. There's another important issue I want to raise to your attention today, and there are a number of claims now arising where Medicare is denying coverage for current ailments based on past claims that we've paid that are completely unrelated. This is occurring in hospice cases, hospice patients being denied care because of an old claim that's not related to their current care. And with that, I will wait for your questions.
Thank you. And by unanimous consent, we'll put in your book and your chart into the record. So done. Okay. Mr. Matsu.
Good morning, Chairman Stearns.
I just need you to pull the mic a little closer.
Good morning. It is. Can everyone hear me? Okay. Good morning, Chairman Stearns, Ranking Member DeGett, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for your leadership in holding this important hearing. I greatly appreciate the opportunity to testify on how the Medicare secondary payer system impacts Medicare beneficiaries. My name is Jason Matsis. I'm a partner at the law firm of Raisman, Frischman, and Matsis. My firm is based in the Pittsburgh area, represented by Congressman Tim Murphy of this committee. I have handled hundreds of personal injury claims, including those resulting from auto liability and other personal injury claims. In many of these cases, I am representing Medicare beneficiaries in their claims against third parties. In that capacity, I have firsthand experience with many of the unintended consequences of the MSP system. I fully support the intent of the MSP requirement to make sure Medicare is repaid when someone else has accepted liability for a beneficiary's medical care. But the current MSP system causes many problems for the beneficiaries I represent and delays or even prevents full repayment to the trust fund. The unfortunate reality is that in practice, the current MSP system harms not only beneficiaries, but the trust fund as well. The most significant problem my beneficiary clients face is that the current MSP system administered by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services is running the process backwards. We cannot get the final demand explaining how much money is owed to Medicare until after a case settles and is reported to CMS. As the prior witnesses on this panel have noted, this is causing many significant problems and harms everyone involved, including ultimately the Medicare Trust Fund itself. The backward recovery process is creating significant obstacles that make it very difficult for cases to settle. The amount of money that will need to be repaid to Medicare is a critical piece of information. a piece of information that we currently cannot get when we need it most during settlement negotiations. This problem, this lack of critical information, is causing more and more cases to go to trial instead of being settled, simply because nobody has a reliable final number from Medicare of what the trust fund is owed. More cases going to trial rather than settling outside of courtrooms necessarily means that ultimately less money will be recovered by Medicare. That is obviously contrary to the primary goal of the MSP system. Thus, the current recovery process actually works against the goal of recovering as much money as possible for the trust fund. Even if I settle a case without knowing the final number, which happens, there are still extreme delays in getting that final demand amount from Medicare. Even once the beneficiaries have settled their claims or won their case in court and the required reporting has been made to Medicare, my clients still must wait and wait and wait to receive anything from their settlements. It is not at all uncommon for it to take 6 months or even a year just to resolve the MSP portion of a claim. My firm alone has had many instances of such cases for beneficiaries when it took that long. Of course, my beneficiary clients are not the only ones who are waiting to be paid during this time. The Medicare Trust Fund also does not get reimbursed until we are told the final demand amount. In the aggregate, these delays translate into millions of dollars of lost revenue annually for the Medicare Trust Fund, a system that harms both the Medicare beneficiaries and the Trust Fund simply cannot be right. These long delays are causing significant financial strains for many beneficiaries who have been injured. At my firm, we have had instances where the Medicare beneficiary faced the prospect of foreclosure on their home because of the delay in getting the Medicare reimbursement resolved. This can happen when a Medicare beneficiary is counting on the settlement proceeds to reimburse them for the out-of-pocket costs associated with their injury, such as co-pays, uncovered medical services, and lost wages. Fortunately, we have avoided that calamity, but the issues are real. Tragically, a colleague of mine has told me of an instance where the beneficiary has died during the interim period waiting for the MSP portion of the claim to be resolved after the case is settled. I strongly urge this committee and Congress to empower Medicare to provide a final demand amount before settlements occur, so that everyone would know how much money is owed and would be able to settle accordingly. If that were to occur, the beneficiaries that I represent would be far better off than they are today, and the trust fund would recover many millions of dollars more than is the case today. If this simple change occurred, both beneficiaries and Medicare could receive their reimbursements much faster than they do today. Let me be clear. We are ready and able to reimburse the trust fund, but we need your help to clear the bureaucracy out of the way and make a sensible MSP system that will actually work. 1 month ago, I had the privilege of meeting with Representative Tim Murphy, along with approximately 30 other lawyers from the Pittsburgh area on this issue, all interested stakeholders on this issue. As we asked Congressman Murphy last month, I joined with my colleagues in respectfully urging you to allow us to quickly and efficiently resolve MSP claims. I thank you for the opportunity to testify today before the subcommittee, and I welcome any questions that you have.
I thank gentlemen. Ms. Stein, welcome for your five-minute opening statement.
Good morning, Chairman Stearns, Ranking Member DeGette, and other distinguished members of the subcommittee. I thank you for the opportunity to testify today about the current secondary payer program and the difficulties Medicare beneficiaries face navigating the system. I am Eileen Stein, Federal Policy Director for the Medicare Rights Center. Medicare Rights is a national nonprofit consumer service organization that works to ensure access to affordable health care for older adults and people with disabilities. Last year, we assisted more than 14,000 Medicare beneficiaries and nearly 4,000 healthcare professionals through our national helpline. These calls inform our public policy efforts and allow Medicare Rights to bring the voice of Medicare beneficiaries to the national conversation about Medicare. For the health and integrity of the Medicare program, a robust secondary payer regime is necessary. However, the current system is flawed in both policy and implementation. the results can be devastating for Medicare beneficiaries. Not only do individuals receive demands from Medicare for large amounts of money that, in some cases, they do not owe and or cannot pay, but in certain situations, Medicare will cease coverage because cases were improperly closed by CMS and MSPRC. Though not all-inclusive nor mutually exclusive, the problems we identified with the secondary payer process fall into five categories. The first is untimely collection of Medicare's share of settlements. Currently, there is no established time frame by which Medicare must tell individuals what they owe if they have settled a liability case. If a beneficiary settles without knowing the Medicare costs, Medicare may come back years later and collect a sizable portion of the settlement. In some instances, given the lapse in time and because the beneficiary is unaware that Medicare is owed money, settlement funds may no longer exist. The second issue is that CMS and MSPRC often miscalculates the amount that Medicare is owed. Frequently, callers to our helpline receive notices from MSPRC requesting repayment for treatments that are unrelated to injuries associated with a previous accident. This is because CMS and the contractor do not properly segregate claims related to accidents from other claims completely unrelated to those past injuries. The third issue concerns beneficiaries' difficulty in obtaining information about their cases from CMS and MSPRC. Callers experience extremely long hold times, and even when individuals are able to reach customer service representatives, they receive inaccurate or incomplete information. Fourth, beneficiaries who manage to get an explanation often find the source of the issue to be that CMS and MSPRC did not properly close their case. As a result, even though the insurance company has closed the case, the Medicare system believes that Medicare is still a secondary payer. Consequently, Medicare conditionally pays, sending demands for reimbursement to beneficiaries, or stops paying for services altogether. Such a serious matter should be resolved quickly, but it often can take up to a year to get the case closed. Finally, notices sent to consumers by MSPRC are not clear. While they speak to appeal rights, they do not contain detailed information on how to request an appeal or about the documentation necessary to be successful. Notices also fail to elucidate the hardship waiver process available if consumers are unable to pay Medicare the money being requested. There are several steps that can be taken legislatively or administratively that would help solve many of the problems that beneficiaries encounter. Ideally, as soon as incidents are reported to Medicare, Medicare would then provide the insurer and the beneficiary with an estimate of the conditional payments made by Medicare for treatment related to the injury, as well as an estimate of future treatment. Medicare collection practices should ensure timely recovery. Medicare secondary payer claims should not be initiated more than 2 years after the settlement has been made. This would also help to ensure that in settlement negotiations and legal proceedings, all parties are able to consider Medicare's claims. CMS and its contractors should be required to improve the notices provided to consumers. Specifically, the notices language must be more consumer-friendly, and the notices should include more detailed information about appeal and hardship waiver rights and processes. MSPRC should be required to maintain a transparent, easy-to-use process through which beneficiaries and their representatives can obtain information about their cases. This means both ensuring shorter call times and, more importantly, assigning a specific staff member to cases who can be reached directly. CMS and its contractor should develop a better process for separating claims that are not related to an accident. CMS and the contractor should also be required to make decisions expediently when beneficiaries dispute the inclusion of claims because they do not believe that they relate back to an accident. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. I'd be happy to respond to any questions from the committee.
I thank Ms. Stein. Mr. Gillian, looking at that report, have there been other versions of this? I understand there's been three versions of this 200-plus page report that's guidance. Is that true?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. The copy I have is version 3.1.
Okay.
So there's been at least three versions.
Now, has this provided you with any kind of guidance? Just yes or no?
Kind of.
Not really. Okay. Mr. Salm, I just want to quickly take us through the process here, recovery process for liability insurance, no-fault insurance, and workman's compensation, just to make sure all of us understand it correctly. The first step in the MSP recovery process is that you report your case to a contractor at CMS, correct?
Yes. Well, no, sir.
Okay.
You have to understand that, especially in a liability standpoint, we have a tremendous amount of process, the American legal system, that goes on before we ever get to this.
So that's not the first step.
No. Well, the first step, as far as the agency is concerned, is that they want us to report the settlement to the agency. Okay. But before we go through that, we would go through an entire claims operation, a litigation operation. Understand that from our standpoint, this is coming very near the end of the process. And speed is a great priority at the end of the process, because frequently we don't get to this number until we're actually facing a trial date.
So once a case has been established, then you receive a rights and responsibility letter about protecting Medicare's interest in the settlement negotiations. Is that correct?
There is a rights and responsibilities letter, right, that talks about that.
Then you're supposed to receive a conditional payment letter. Is that right?
At some point, you're supposed to receive a conditional payment letter. I can tell you that in the times that my adjusters have requested the conditional payment letter, including the appropriate release from claimants, we have never received a conditional payment letter.
Well, isn't that the law, that you're supposed to receive a conditional payment letter?
We can get the amount of the payments made by Medicare, but we can't get a letter that actually indicates how much money we owe Medicare until after we report to them how much we've settled the lawsuit for.
And how long does it generally take CMS to provide you with a conditional payment amount?
Once we make the request, it'll take I've never seen one less than 90 days, and more likely it's more like 6 months. Also, Mr. Chairman, if I know, when we get the conditional payment amount for Medicare, it says right on the letter that we get, and I have a copy of it, it says, "This is not a bill. Do not send a payment at this time," right on the document.
Can we get a copy of that? Make it
absolutely
sent part of the record.
Absolutely.
And this is prior to settlement, right?
This would be prior to settlement. Yes, sir.
How and when are changes in this amount, as well as the amount of future payments you're responsible for, communicated to you and other parties in the lawsuit?
I don't know.
Okay. Let me ask each of you, you described this bureaucratic inefficiency, and I think you've touched on it. What is the number one thing, we'll just go from my left to right, that you would like to see changed immediately?
I'd like to be able to get the amount that we owe Medicare before we settle the claim.
And what would that duration be, generally, just average?
How long would it take us
to get?
I think the timeline set forth in HR 1063, which would be either 65 or 95 days, would be sufficiently quick so we could resolve lawsuits.
Okay, Mr. Gilliam.
Number one thing
that you would like to see fixed.
What he said plus responsiveness from MSPRC. We are waiting for final demand letters from them for 11 months, 12 months, 14 months, 18 months, 6 months, 6 months, 7 months, 7, 7, and 8. They never send letters. We're on hold for 56 minutes or an hour or 90 minutes.
Now, Ms. Taylor said that there are 413,000 cases, and she couldn't even answer the duration time, but you're giving us some pretty dramatic long durations here of even trying to get information.
And many of these are after 7 to 10 attempts at phone calls.
And you're on the phone for an hour?
90 minutes.
90
One time they hung up, then they transferred us, and we were on hold for 90 minutes.
And is there music going on?
I don't know.
I hope the people you're talking to are people in the United States.
Pardon?
Are the people you're talking to in the United States?
Yes.
They don't farm it out to India, do they?
No.
Okay. Mr. Matsu, what is the number one thing that you think?
Mr. Chairman, the number one priority would be to get the final demand number from Medicare prior to the settlement.
Okay. And Ms. Stein?
I guess the statute of limitations on how long it would take for Medicare to collect their share, as well as more transparency with the contractor. We also experience long wait times and have difficulty resolving cases. It requires us to resend documentation over and over again. We have cases that have lasted over a year to close.
Have you had the experience, Ms. Gilliam, talked about 90 minutes on the phone?
Yes. I would say the least amount of time we have to wait on the phone is about 30 minutes. We've had to wait up into for over an hour, I think an hour and 20 minutes.
So you've waited an hour and 20 minutes. So you have one of your employees just putting it on speaker and waiting there all during that period of time.
Indeed. I actually have personally waited on the phone for.
You personally have waited.
Yes.
And during that time, is there somebody that comes in during those hour and 20 minutes that says, thank you for holding, or is it just a dead phone, or what is it?
The case I handled is probably 2 years old. It's mostly just music, I think.
Just music?
But I do have to say that once we do actually reach an operator, we'll have about a maybe a several-minute conversation where they say, please resend your documentation. It isn't on file. Oh. And then you have to call back again.
I'll just close. When you do this, do you have to put things through, like they want information keyboard in, that you have to put in a lot of documentation before they even talk to you?
In some cases, yes. It depends on the case.
You got to put the case number, dates, and things like that in before they even go further. Because you can't talk to anybody first. You're talking to a computer, right?
Right. Well, and also, if somebody has a representative, they have to submit the documentation, the appointment of representative form as well, which often gets lost.
Okay. My time has expired.
Thanks. So to follow up on that, Mr. Gilliam, the other problem is people don't have one customer service agent assigned to them. So, like, let's say you guys have 10 cases. You have to call back each time with each separate case, right? You can't just call someone up and go, okay, here's the 10 issues I want to talk to you about.
That's correct. Every time we call, and if we're lucky enough to get through, it starts over with somebody new, and they won't even accept emails.
Right.
It has to be phone calls or in writing.
Yeah. Mr. Matsis, I have a question for you. In the earlier panel, they were talking about the medical costs vis-a-vis the settlements of these lawsuits. They're talking about the medical costs versus the pain and suffering. And I wasn't a personal injury lawyer, but I hung around with a bunch of them. And my understanding of the way these cases are usually settled, you've got a clear statement of the medical costs, and then you might have pain and suffering or whatever else. But the medical costs aren't normally the pain and suffering, correct?
No, Carl.
I mean, normally those are two different areas.
That is correct.
Especially in the settlement, right?
Medical costs are a separate silo.
That's correct.
Separate and distinct from the recovery for non-economic damage,
right,
such as pain and suffering.
Right.
That's correct.
And so it wouldn't be accurate to say, I mean, that's why you need to have the medical cost information up front at settlement, so we can accurately figure out how much the victims needed to be compensated and then how much needed to be reimbursed to Medicare out of that settlement, right?
It's a necessary and critical part of the equation to figure out what is a fair value at which to agree to settle.
And I've got to say, we rarely ever see the grocery stores and the trial lawyers sitting at the same table agreeing on an issue. So this is I wish those close-up kids were still here to see this comment.
Mark this day on the calendar, I think, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, right, exactly. Ms. Stein, I wanted to ask you about a little bit of what you were talking about, what I mentioned in my opening statement about the program's beneficiaries, because we keep hearing these stories about Medicare coming after beneficiaries years after the cases have been settled for reimbursement for medical expenses. And the case I talked about in my opening statement was an 81-year-old woman who got hit by a drunk driver. She got $20,000 from automobile insurance in a settlement. And then 13 years later, so add that up, 94 she is now, Medicare sends her a letter demanding repayments of medical services over a decade old. Have you heard similar stories about beneficiaries being contacted by Medicare years after settlement demanding payment?
Yes, we've heard cases like that, and obviously, and this kind of speaks a little bit to the hardship waiver process, it's pretty difficult to get a waiver. The process is burdensome to consumers, and the situations that hardship waivers apply to are somewhat arbitrary. For example, somebody who is on SSI, which is obviously low income, that doesn't necessarily automatically make them eligible for some type of waiver, either full or partial waiver. In my written testimony, I talked about, and this speaks back to the idea that claims aren't properly segregated, that individuals who were in car accidents, 5 to 10 years ago suddenly receive bills from Medicare or no longer able to receive Medicare coverage going forward because they claim that, a broken hip that they received in their kitchen, it relates back to a car accident that happened, over 5 to 10 years ago.
So there needs to be some kind of a time frame. Claims shouldn't be initiated maybe 2 years after settlement or something like that, correct?
Yes.
Now, but that does lead us to a question, and I'm wondering if any of you have an opinion on this, is it makes perfect sense to me to have all of the data at settlement or shortly thereafter. But you have a little tension here because if you have medical claims that continue to come in, we want to assure that we get the taxpayer gets reimbursed for those expenses. But on the other hand, you want to have a quick settlement. So what can we do to make that system work better? So we have some closure early on at settlement or soon after, but at the same time, we're not leaving medical costs out there that could be recaptured.
If I could jump in there, in probably 95% of the cases, when we are ready for the Medicare number, the treatment is basically done. It's typical that when we try and settle claims, and Jason knows this, we want to get all the numbers together. In most cases, the plaintiff is done treating, and so we have all the data, and that's when we need to know what Medicare owes. And at that point, all of the Medicare paid treatment has been completed, and we don't understand why they can't tell us what that number is.
Does everybody else pretty much agree with that statement?
We very much agree with this. Plaintiff's lawyers don't bring cases to resolution or settlement until they know what the total medical care is that they want to get reimbursed for. Another point is made that in the normal practice of subrogation, what normal insurance companies, corporations do all the time, you have to, if you're ever going to get your money, you have to make a decision to cut off sort of chasing the dollars at some point because you're just not going to get enough money to justify the effort you put into it. So Mr. Gilman and I make decisions on subrogation every day, and we say, okay, we'll take X number of dollars now because we don't think we're going to get X plus 20 later, or it's just going to take too much time.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized for 5 minutes. Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think the more I hear here, the more it boggles the mind and breaks the heart when we hear what happens to seniors. A couple things first, Mr. Gilliam. In retail settings, I understand that sometimes someone may get injured, but they say, look, I'm not going to sue the store. I think accidents happen, but I need to make sure my medical expenses are taken care of. And sometimes stores say, we still want to show good faith effort. Here's a gift card to use at our store, things like that. That happens, am I correct?
Yes, that happens. That happens thousands of times.
Do you have to report that number yet?
Well, we don't have to report that number yet, but we will have to report that number in 3 years.
So if someone gets a $25 or $50 gift card off their groceries, will Medicare, according to the new rules, come after them and say, you owe us that money to reimburse for medical expenses?
Absolutely. We will have to report that under the new rules. We'll have to report that under the process. And Medicare, we become a primary payer in that.
So you have someone who's living off of Social Security, and they think, my goodness, I get basically a half a bag of groceries for free here. Now Medicare is going to come back and say, we want that food back. You need that $25 or $50 back. That's what you're telling me.
That's what I'm telling you. Yes, sir.
Breaks the heart. Mr. Matthews, when you were describing this case of someone who died before then, too, someone is waiting for this claim, does it actually impose other hardships upon the seniors in a couple levels? So number one, do you know of any cases out there where because of the amount of money that's kind of in the air, or in the claims being made by Medicare against someone to come up with some reimbursements, that seniors may actually delay other health care because they don't have the money to take care of themselves?
Congressman Murphy, I think, as everybody As everybody on the panel can appreciate, most Medicare beneficiaries have limited financial resources. A small change in their monthly costs can push them very quickly beyond the financial tipping point from which they cannot or will have a very difficult time recovering. And oftentimes when you have to make a decision between paying for current uncovered Medicare services that you need versus paying other bills, people choose to pay for the necessary uncovered medical services and, in essence, are robbing Peter to pay Paul.
And on this, I'm assuming while you're working on a case, they're also accruing other legal expenses, which, because of the delays and people having to sit on the phone and wait for calls. Am I correct in that, too?
Congressman Murphy, the way our firm operates, it's a contingency fee basis. So we don't bill our clients based upon an hourly rate.
Some may do that.
Some firms may.
So in some cases, it may cost the seniors even more. So the delay is costing seniors not only they're delaying some care, maybe not doing some care, maybe having to pay back grocery money, et cetera. If the person or if the parties settle without the final demand letter, what happens to the senior settlement money? Anybody know?
If I may, typically the settlement money is held in a law firm's client trust account or escrow account pending final notice from Medicare of what amount's owed, and then distribution is only made after the final demand figure.
And what if that final demand figure is much higher than the conditional payment? Who pays the difference? Does that happen?
It can happen. Colleagues have reported that happening. It has not been my personal experience where there's been a significant difference. But in theory, the beneficiary and or the law firm and or the liability carrier is potentially responsible. We don't have the opportunity to go back in time and get a second bite at the mm-hmm. apple in a liability settlement. Once a case is settled, it's settled. The money that's received is the only money that will be received.
And does it take as long if you're dealing with private insurance companies as it takes with Medicare?
To get the final lien figure? No.
How long would they typically take?
We always have the final lien figure in advance of.
So it's humanly possible to do this?
It is. By way of example, Medicaid.
Now, I know that the CFO of CMS has other things to do today, but I would hope it's something that would save taxpayers billions. Save seniors a lot of headache and maybe save some lives here. I hope that information is getting to her. One other thing I want to read briefly, and this is from a magazine called Mother Jones, not my usual reading, but I found it interesting that it talks about a case here, and I'd like to submit this for the record too, Mr. Chairman, where
by unanimous consent to order.
Where someone actually got snared by Medicare twice, it says, the first time in 2002 when the agency began seizing her only income, a $498 monthly Social Security check for nearly 3 years. Until she repaid more than $16,000, her settlement minus some legal fees. After that, she thought her troubles were over, but in 2008, Medicare returned for more. Its $66,000 bill not only failed to recognize that Corey had already repaid what she owed, it also far exceeded the $20,000 she'd received from her daughter's insurance company in the first place. And eventually, this person, a former accountant, discovered that Medicare had included every procedure Molly had undergone since her accident, including unrelated care like open-heart surgery and treatment for emphysema, and, of course, cases like this in abound. And I'm hoping that one of the outcomes of this hearing, Mr. Chairman, is that we hear from cases throughout the country, we just have got to fix this problem. It is hurting too many seniors and hurting the taxpayers. And I join my colleague from Colorado in saying when you have retailers, plaintiff's attorneys, defense attorneys, those advocates of senior citizens all agreeing this has to be fixed. It's time to fix it, and I yield back my time. Thank you.
Gentleman yields back his time. We recognize the chairman emeritus of the Energy and Commerce Committee, Mr. Dingell from Michigan, for 5 minutes.
Questions will be directed at you. Sounds like the Medicare secondary payer reimbursement process is lengthy, burdensome and complex for beneficiaries and attorneys to navigate. Why doesn't Medicare pursue reimbursement from the primary payment or a primary payer directly?
Congressman Dingell, my hunch on that would be from a cost efficiency standpoint, it's more cost effective for Medicare to recover money in a passive manner as opposed to direct intervention in pursuit of claims.
All right. Now, what happens if beneficiaries decide they don't want to pursue claims? For example, if an 89-year-old woman broke her leg in a car accident and then decided not to file an insurance claim or pursue any other form of recompense, wouldn't Medicare then be stuck with all the bills without any form of reimbursement?
In practical
reality,
that's
a very real problem, isn't it?
It is.
All right. Now, and I'm sorry to hurry you, but time here is limited. It's my understanding from your testimony that if you are unable to reimburse Medicare until after the parties have reached a settlement, you have a final demand letter from CMS, and those often take many months or even years to get. Is this the case, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what happens to the beneficiary settlement money in the intervening time? Is the beneficiary able to access the money?
No.
In your experience from working on such cases, how long is the settlement money typically in limbo before Medicare is reimbursed?
A short period of time would be 3 or 4 months. A typical period of time is probably 6 to 9 months or longer.
Now, you and I are both attorneys, and I'm sort of curious. As a fellow attorney, how does this affect the attorney-client relationship?
It creates significant problems with the attorney-client relationship.
Now, the next question is to you again, Mr. Matsis, Mr. Sam, and Mr. Gilliam. Mr. Matsis, Mr. Sam, and Mr. Gilliam, has your business or other businesses similar to yours incurred additional costs as a result of lengthy and burdensome Medicare secondary payment reimbursement process, yes or no?
A big yes.
Mr. Sam.
Sorry.
Yes, we have.
Okay. Mr. Matsis?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what effects have these costs had on your business, starting with Mr. Sam, Mr. Gilliam, and then Mr. Matsis?
The first effect we've had is we've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars in an attempt to get Medicare the data that they need in the workers' comp setting. The second effect it's had is delayed the resolution of liability claims while we've been waiting to figure out what Medicare's number is and get the money to Medicare. The longer a case stays open, the more the case costs somebody like Public Supermarkets, and the slower it is to get to the beneficiaries.
So it hurts both. It hurts most everybody involved.
Yeah, it hurts the primary company like Publix. It hurts an insurance company like Cincinnati. It hurts the plaintiff's attorney who's waiting to get his money and to deal with his client. And of course, it hurts the person that we're all talking about here, the beneficiary, because these are people who are waiting for their money in a liability claim situation.
All right, Mr. Gilliam, your additional comments.
Yes, we've incurred hundreds of thousands, if not millions, complying with this reporting manual, trying to collect the data and keep it safe from hackers so we can report it. It so delays the claim settlement process. And at my company, we have a philosophy. We're in the claims-paying business. We like to speedily end claims. We don't like to have people upset that they're waiting. And the longer we have to keep a file open, the more it costs us and takes our adjusters away from handling current claims as they shepherd these old claims.
Mr. Matsis?
Congressman, more important than the cost to our firm are the costs and the financial consequences as well as the emotional consequences to Medicare beneficiaries. While putting more work and time into a case does increase our cost, most importantly, the significant costs are by the delay or borne by the Medicare beneficiaries.
Thank you. Now, last question, gentlemen. What expectations do you have for the future if costs associated with Medicare secondary payment reimbursements remain the same or increase? In other words, what does the future hold if costs remain the same or increase? And don't be shy.
The nightmare continues and gets worse. We end up spending all of our time dealing with computers and being on the phone for an hour and a half when we could be helping people.
Now, we also have reason to think that it will probably increase over time, do we not? and that means there will be a multiplier effect take place, does it not?
Well, if they would simply start over and ask us what kind of data do we already collect, we might already have the data they want, but they ask us to collect all this ridiculous data that doesn't really help them identify who owes them money. Talk to us about what we already have, and maybe we already have it.
My time has expired, and I thank the chair for it, but would you each submit to us for purposes of the record your suggestions about what should be done to correct this intolerable situation and make it better from your standpoint, from the standpoint of the patients and the beneficiaries, and from the standpoint of the government, if you please. And I'd ask, Mr. Chairman, that the record remain open for that purpose.
All right. The gentleman's request is obliged with, and the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Gingrich, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Mr. Matzis, you had, in responding to Ms. Dingell in regard to the amount of time, the so-called limbo period, I think you said 3 to 4 months, but it typically 6 to 9 months. Let's reference a medical malpractice tort case where there's a settlement or a judgment, in fact. During that period of time, that limbo period, who actually controls the proceeds?
The proceeds are typically provided to the law firm, the plaintiff's law firm, and the money is held in the plaintiff's firm's escrow account.
All right, and thank you for that answer. So the money is controlled during that limbo period by plaintiff's attorney, by the law firm, and you say it's placed in escrow. Are there limitations in regard to what you can do with that escrow account? Let's say, can you put it in a money market fund? Can you put it in a local bank? And if there's interest generated on that money during that interim, who does that interest go to? Does it go to the plaintiff, the injured party, or does it go to the law firm?
It goes to neither, as I understand it.
Who does it go to? Does it go to charity?
If there's interest that occurred, that's a good question. I don't exactly know. Typically, if the money is held in a client on trust account, the interest would, I guess, ultimately in the aggregate go to the particular state's client trust program.
Well, in my humble opinion, I would think it should go to the injured party, to the plaintiff, ultimately. Let me ask this question of Ms. Stein. You're an advocate for Medicare beneficiaries, and we appreciate that. In regard to this requirement to pay back Medicare for the cost that they've incurred, and this subrogation requirement that's in the law, if the injured party is still living, and it's been 2 years later that they get this demand letter from Medicare, does Medicare have the authority within the law to put a lien on Social Security benefits, as an example, if that happens to be their only asset?
Yes, they could actually begin to deduct money from the Social Security benefit.
And if the individual is deceased by the time they get that demand letter, the lien would be against their estate if they have any value there.
Yes, I believe that's the case.
All right, thank you. Let me ask one quick question of everybody. We heard Ms. Taylor testify that CMS does provide Medicare secondary payment reimbursement amount in a timely manner. However, the testimony of this panel, the four of you, seems to contradict that statement. But let me just ask you one by one, starting with Mr. Salem. Does CMS consistently provide the amount owed to Medicare in a timely fashion before the case is settled? Yes or no?
No, they can't. The regulations prohibit them from giving us the final payout amount before the case is settled.
Do they provide you, I'll add to it, a reasonable estimate of what the cost is?
They provide a conditional payment, a conditional payment letter. The time that it takes to get the conditional payment letter ranges between, for a party like mine, never, and 6 months. But we make an awful lot of requests for these, and they frequently respond back. We have no record of this file.
If they, and again, I wanted all of you to answer this, and I'm expanding the question a bit, but if they make an estimate, would it be reasonable to say that then the maximum amount that they could eventually recover would be within a certain percentage point above that estimate and no more.
I think that's fair.
Let's go ahead, Mr. Gillum.
We never get timely numbers. I don't know of any instance where we got a timely number. I think Mrs. Taylor talked about 65 days. If they gave us a number in 65 days, we'd be dancing in the street and back home in Cincinnati and not here in Washington.
Mr. Matzis.
The CPL letters, the conditional payment letters, are not generally provided timely within the 65-day period. In regard to your last point about the if Medicare was limited in the amount that they could recover by a percentage above the figure in the CPL, that would be very, very helpful. Currently, there is no such limitation. So from a practical perspective, the CPL number is meaningless because it's not a final number.
Right. And finally, Ms. Stein.
I agree. I think that it would be extremely helpful to limit it. I think it would also help in closing cases in a timely manner. So again, when claims aren't properly segregated, individuals aren't receiving notices, you know, 10 years later, or they're not able to access Medicare coverage because there's been a lien against them.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your patience with
me. Well, thank you. And I just want to follow up with what you would indicate. Actually, this Mother Earth article, Ms. Corey, who got in an automobile accident in 1995, Medicare actually confiscated her Social Security check of $498 in 2002. So she was 88 years old, and Medicare came in and confiscated it for 3 years until she repaid more than $16,000, her settlement minus some legal fees. So, I mean, that's an egregious example. In closing, I just want to put into the record, I have in my hand an MSP demands for $1.59, $2.81, and $4.82. I ask unanimous consent to be part of the record. And Mr. Salm, is this a frequent instance of where Medicare is spending, you know, 43% of its time for pursuing 2% of its dollars? I mean,
It's impossible for me to tell how frequent it is given the difficulty of collecting information, but I have additional claims with me for $36.75, $42.50, $44.83, and I think the biggest one I have is $69.62. When you consider that there's $1 billion at stake, it seems to me that this is not a good use of our government's time.
On the $36, how long did it take?
I can't tell you. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, if I could jump in, we have a claim that we've been waiting for 14 months for Medicare to accept our payment of $16.54.
$16?
Yes. We've called them. We've written them. And so 14 months later, a file is still open waiting for a release from Medicare, and they haven't even cashed our check for $16.54.
I wonder why they haven't cashed your check. Part of the bureaucracy. Mr. Matsu? Is this sort of typical of the frequency, you know, or how frequent does this occur in your litigation?
It doesn't occur in our litigation.
You got your mic on?
Oh.
Doesn't occur?
It doesn't occur in our practice.
Okay. Ms. Stein, is this?
Mostly the clients that call us tend to have Medicare claims higher amounts above $5,000, but we did have a case recently that was $35.
And to make you more angry, 24 months for a $91 payment. We're waiting 24 months.
24 months for a $91 payment.
To be accepted.
Wow. Well, I think we've finished our hearing. Mr. Gett, is there anything you'd like to add? With that, I think we'll close the hearing. I want to thank you for your forbearance for waiting as a second panelist. I think clearly this agency, Medicare, has not worked well with the secondary payment. And we, as members of Congress, are going to have a second hearing, if possible, on this. And we look forward to trying to solve these problems. And thank you for your interest.
Thank you.